You're listening to the audio production of Night Train to Nashville, The Greatest Untold Story of Music City, by Paula Blackman, published by Harper Horizon, and read by Paula Blackman and Matt Richbourg.
From my late mother, Anne, the talented wordsmith who nurtured me, my father, Ed, whose tough love gave me the perseverance necessary to turn a lofty dream into a reality, my Aunt Gail, and my grandparents, Christine and Gab, whose love of life, family, and Southern storytelling inspired this book. I love you all. Prologue, Sentimental Journey. We started playing R&B with a definite purpose. We were trying to open up a new market, and we knew what we were doing. John Richbourg. My grandfather, E. Gab Blackie Blackman, kept a pair of well-worn, two-tone leather dance shoes in his closet, a cherished relic from another time. They stood apart from the wingtips, topsiders, golf shoes, and slippers he wore regularly. In the heaviness of their metal heel plates and stubbornness of the creases, the shoes seemed to boast of having taken him on a sentimental journey. When he was in his late 80s, and walked with a cane, I asked if he planned to go dancing anytime soon. He laughed, blue eyes sparkling, and said, "I didn't keep those shoes for dancing. I kept them for their story." Night Train to Nashville is that story. I unknowingly began my research on the Night Train story in 1972. Each summer, I would spend many weeks at my grandparents' home on Old Hickory Lake near Nashville. However, the summer of 72 was special because it was the first time I'd had my grandparents to myself since my brothers were born. Mom was pregnant with my sister, and my brothers, involved in sports, couldn't leave Omaha where we lived at the time. I was 15 going on 30, according to my father, who was 35 going on 15, according to my mother. On the last night of the school year, I had slipped out of my bedroom window to attend a party my father had forbidden. When I came home in the wee hours, I discovered my window locked and my father waiting by the front door. "Hopeless? You're grounded for life," he yelled. Because my middle name was Hope, my father had nicknamed me Hopeless. He confined me to the house where I sulked and whined and complained, as only a teenage girl can, until my very pregnant mother determined she was enduring the brunt of my dad's punishment. Exhausted from the constant tension between my father and me, my mother declared herself to be on the verge of a nervous breakdown. To keep the peace, Dad sent me to stay with his parents, Gab and Christine, whom I called Pop and T. It was the greatest summer of my life. I packed my suitcase with my summertime essentials, a church dress, two bikinis, Daisy Duke cutoffs, a pair of white Keds, and my favorite albums, mostly Motown, featuring Diana Ross, Stevie Wonder, and Marvin Gaye, supplemented by a few 45s from Carole King and James Taylor. I listened primarily to rhythm and blues, R&B, and while I'd visited Pop's office and met the DJs, it wasn't until that summer I learned of the significant role WLAC played in the development of R&B. When I placed my beloved Supremes farewell album on the hi-fi, my grandfather said, "You know, Diana Ross gave us a lot of credit for her success." "Gave who?" "Us, WLAC. He told me stories of why he joined WLAC and how he and Gene Nobles pioneered R&B programming long before Berry Gordy Jr. and Smokey Robinson came to the station to pitch him their new venture, Motown. Pop was a master front porch storyteller, pre-television style. He had the gift Robert Penn Warren described as having sprung from the pores of Southern society. Elaborate, winding, wandering creations that might never wear out. Stories full of human perception and subtlety, told with a richness of laughter and expression. Not idle gossip, not diversions, mind you, but tales of wit and character, pathos and scope. I had the great fortune of hearing my grandfather tell his stories in that rich Southern style. They captivated me, and I couldn't get enough of them. Many nights after dinner, we would hop into his convertible Carmen Ghia and drive to the Tasty Freeze, where he'd order a vanilla cone, and I'd get rainbow sherbet. The car's headlight dimmer switch had been rigged to tune the radio to WLAC. We'd cruise, top down, and as it was too early for WLAC's R&B broadcasts, I'd scan the stations for a Motown song I could sing along to. After my lyrical knowledge display, Pop would tap the dimmer, return to WLAC, and tell me a story related to the time, place, and musician we'd just heard. He didn't love the music, not the way I did. However, he loved the musicians, especially B.B. King, and his DJs, particularly Hoss Allen. Night Train to Nashville is a compilation of as many of these stories as I can recall. In addition to chronicling Pop's firsthand accounts of the legendary broadcasts, I have spent the better part of the last 15 years verifying his tales, reading, researching, and interviewing the people who experienced these events with him, including B.B. King and Little Richard. The Night Train to Nashville story was fairly well known locally, following the Country Music Hall of Fame and Museum's exhibit of the same name. The museum's retrospective told a fascinating, although incomplete, story of the origin of rhythm and blues on WLAC. This book seeks to tell the rest of the story, the authentic lost history that was never revealed because it was not politically correct. That is, not the Nashville way. Instead, a press release version was circulated that omitted key details and led listeners to assume WLAC's extraordinary success happened accidentally. However, to anyone familiar with the Jim Crow South, the tale of two young black men who entered the locked Third National Bank building, bypassed security, rode an operator-manned elevator to the top floor, got past the locked lobby doors, and then into a locked broadcast booth where they interrupted an on-air announcer who pleasantly asked the unwelcome intruders what he could do for them. Sounded too fishy to be true. For 60 years, folks have scratched their heads over how that had happened. The big hole in the story is obvious, isn't it? They had been invited and escorted. What follows is the true, little-known account of how and why Gab Blackman launched the first national broadcast of what was then considered taboo race music. WLAC's foray into R&B was not accidental, nor was it done for socially progressive reasons. And make no mistake, neither Gab Blackman nor WLAC's owner Truman Ward was a white savior. The reality was the opposite. Black musicians saved radio. The prevailing thought at the time was television would kill radio. WLAC's revolutionary broadcast was created as a hedge against that anticipated catastrophe. What they hadn't anticipated was that this music, considered too low class and dirty for the airwaves, would attract a mixed race audience and inspire a cultural revolution. While this story may seem like ancient history, what Gab experienced during this time of great societal change is relevant to understanding the nation's current racial tensions. When I first listened to my grandfather's stories, it was the music and the musicians that interested me. However, as I dug deeper through my research, I realized this story was about much more than the music, the broadcasts, and the musicians. It was historically significant because the broadcasts influenced a generation and inspired a cultural revolution. At the time these events occurred, Nashville was segregated, not into separate and equal halves, but ruthlessly and inequitably, like a body beheaded. No interaction between the races existed beyond blacks performing services for whites. When I started elementary school, 3 years after Nashville desegregated, the city still operated this way. And as I was born into this environment, it seemed normal. I went to school with other white children, in the same way I went to Sunday school with other Lutheran children. I never thought it odd, until I left the South. I knew my viewpoints of those events were limited by my own and my grandfather's white perspective. To chronicle this story accurately, I needed a storytelling partner who could provide the black perspective. My husband prayed about it. I meditated. Even as I write this years later, I still find it hard to believe what happened. The next day, Dr. Kenneth Ulmer, a middle-aged black man, walked into my home and changed my life. Ken was about to purchase a home nearby, and when he saw my daughter put an open house sign in our yard, he decided to come in for a peek. We enjoyed a pleasant conversation. Then something auspicious occurred. His wife came in, and he called her T, the same name as my grandmother's. I felt a sense of deja vu and asked Ken if he'd ever heard of Hoss Allen, John R., or Gene Nobles. His face lit up, and he responded in a way only someone familiar with that broadcast could. Randy's? Do I know Randy's? Why, girl, they're the reason I changed my college major from music to radio broadcasting. Then a curious look crossed his face. Better question is, how do you know Randy's? Randy's was the colloquial term the audience used to refer to the nighttime R&B broadcasts after the program's first sponsor, Randy's Records. Dr. Ulmer had listened to the broadcast as a teenager. His perspective was precisely what I lacked. My grandmother used to tell me coincidence was God's secret language, and if my daughter had placed that sign in the yard at any other moment, Dr. Ulmer and I might never have met. Just like that, I found my first storytelling partner. To tell an authentic story of that time and place from the perspective of both races, I alternate narratives between my grandfather and William Sue Bridgeforth. Sue owned Nashville's legendary Chitlin Circuit nightclub, The New Era. Sue's daughter, Harriet Bridgeforth Jordan, became my second storytelling partner, and she provided generous assistance to bring her father's story to life. Thus, Night Train to Nashville is as much Harriet's story as it is mine. Harriet and Dr. Ulmer were united in their belief that I should tell the true, unvarnished history. Where the record shows that characters use the N-word, they requested I not whitewash history to make these real-life people appear less offensive than they were. Over the years it took to research and write this book, Harriet, Dr. Ulmer, and my princely mentor, the late Gregory Allen Howard, became some of my dearest friends. The gratitude I feel for their encouragement, advice, and assistance is unquantifiable. In 1946, when Gene Nobles placed that first race record on the WLAC turntable, he transmitted sounds into the ionosphere that previously had been heard only in black nightclubs. Those revolutionary vibrations received in homes throughout 40 states marked the historic moment that the national airwaves were integrated. Back when the only people who referred to Nashville as Music City were the country music fans who listened to WSM's Grand Ole Opry, WLAC's nighttime rhythm and blues signal served as a beacon that attracted an extraordinary array of musicians to Nashville. B.B. King, James Brown, Little Richard, Muddy Waters, Smokey Robinson, Etta James, Ella Fitzgerald, Jimi Hendrix, Ray Charles, Otis Redding, Diana Ross, Gladys Knight, the list goes on and on. When this music...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.